Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today we'll discuss hypoparathyroidism. In the last lecture, we discussed about the hyperparathyroidism. Basically, you must be able to understand the different causes of hypoparathyroidism and what are the different types, which is also very important. What test should be used for the diagnosis of this condition, laboratory test regarding hypoparathyroidism, and we'll discuss the differential diagnosis of hypoparathyroidism. It is a disease or syndrome due to a transient or permanent lack of PTH or PTH signaling, and can be diagnosed by the combination of low serum ionized or albumin corrected calcium concentration and low or undetectable PTH. In this particular condition, what happens is that we have to document the hypocalcemia. It is documented by either its low serum ionized or albumin corrected total calcium and undetectable or low level of the PTH. There are a lot of different causes of this which can lead to hypoparathyroidism, and we'll discuss these. Permanent deficiency of the PTH, which is secreted by the parathyroid gland, can be due to the autoimmunity. Surgical removal, which may be due to some incidentally by the surgeon, or copper infiltration of the gland. Then transient deficiency due to the hypomagnesemia, and then again surgical injury. In this category, where the permanent deficiency is there, the total, all the four are removed. In this, there may be partial damage to the gland. Then there may be deficiency in the PTH action, that is the target tissue resistance. All are common, but the most important is the autoimmune hypoparathyroidism, which is associated with chronic mucocutaneous candidiasis and primary adrenal insufficiency. This syndrome is known as autoimmune polyendocrine syndrome and is caused by the mutations in the autoimmune regulator gene. So these are the categories, and these are the different causes of hypoparathyroidism. Then there is a term which is called pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. In this particular condition, there is end organ resistance to the actions of the PTH. PTH is available, but its action on the cell is not appropriate. There is a resistance that may be due to the autoimmunity, that may be due to some genetic disorders. The PTH resistance is the most obvious clinical manifestation presenting as hypocalcemia. Along with this, there will be hyperphosphatemia, elevated circulating PTH, and sometimes there is presence of the TSH resistance in the patient also. So pseudo-hypoparathyroidism, whenever you hear the term, it should not be confused with the hypoparathyroidism. This is the different entity. In this, there is resistance to the action of the PTH. This is a rare genetic disorder. It can manifest in the form of the disturbances of the calcium and the phosphorus metabolism. PTH binds to the PTH receptor, which in turn activates cyclic AMP through guanine nucleotide regulatory proteins. The pseudo-hypoparathyroidism, it is an autosomal dominant disease. This is one condition which is Albright hereditary osteodystrophy. It is a rare genetic disorder and inherited from the mother. The features of the AHO or Albright hereditary osteodystrophy can be associated with a resistance to certain hormones other than this one, in particular the parathyroid. Other clinical manifestations of this condition are short stature, round faces. There will be short fourth and the fifth metaphor like this. The knuckle formation will not be the appropriate with the full one. Then there may be subcutaneous calcification of the basal ganglia. Then there may be developmental delays. These are the few features of the Albright's osteodystrophy, which is the pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. Then another term, which is a very long, lengthy, with about more than 30 alphabets, pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. It is an inherited condition that causes short stature, round face, and short hand bones. It is usually inherited from the father. It is called genomic imprinting. This is the abbreviation for this, the PPHP. It's genetically related to the pseudohypoparathyroidism type 1. The features are almost the same. This condition is inherited as an autosomal dominant manner due to the mutation of the in the GNAS gene. Now, if we focus on this slide, here, these are the four things. This is less common, but these three things are more important and to be understood properly. First of all, we'll differentiate it to a few conditions, like primary hyperthyroidism is the first one, which we discussed in the last lecture. The most common cause adenoma, in that there will be high PTH, calcium will be high, phosphorus will be low, and alkaline phosphatase may be borderline high or high. This is the primary hyperparathyroidism. Then there is secondary hyperparathyroidism. This I am discussing with you because after the next lecture, this lecture you will be having some MCQ discussion. So you must go through this one to attempt those questions or to understand the concept of those questions properly. Now, most common cause in this is the chronic kidney disease. PTH will be low, calcium will be low, phosphorus will be high. Remember this one, that calcium and the phosphorus in most conditions go side by side except one. Then there will be high alkaline phosphatase. Then the third condition comes, the hypoparathyroidism. These two conditions were the hyperparathyroidism. Autoimmunity is the most common cause. In that, PTH will be low, calcium will be low, and phosphorus will be high. This can be confused with this one, but in this, the cause is CKD. So other parameters are very obvious, which can identify it as secondary hyperparathyroidism. In this condition, alkaline will be normal. Then comes the pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. The problem is in the causes mutation in the GNAS gene. In this, as compared to this, the PTH will be high because of the resistance to the action of the PTH. So it will be secreted irrespective of the level of the calcium, and it will be high. The calcium will be low. In this, phosphorus will be high and alkaline will be normal. So these four conditions you must keep in mind, and with this chart you can easily identify which parameter will be high and how to approach a patient with the hyperparathyroidism, secondary hyperparathyroidism, or hypoparathyroidism. Or particularly, sometimes you may get the question like hypocalcemia, which we'll discuss later. What are the clinical effects of the hypoparathyroidism? Multiple organs are involved in this one. If you consider, first of all, seizures may be there, calcification in the basal ganglia may be there, neuropsychiatric symptoms like anxiety and the depression may be present, then cardiac arrhythmias, then like cataracts, and then laryngospasm can be there, altered tooth morphology, the dental system will be involved due to the disturbance in the metabolism, then dermatological system, dry skin, then coarse thin hair, then musculoskeletal myopathy. Similarly, in renal system, there may be nephrocalcinosis, kidney stones, chronic kidney disease, then paresthesia. These are all the clinical effects which may be present, not all at one time, but with the later stages of the disease, they can have, patient can suffer from these clinical effects. Now, biochemically, as we discussed, we have to monitor the level of the calcium, which will be low, phosphorus will be high, PTH will be low, and magnesium level will be low. These three are more important. Normally, it is also measured, but not as a routine for the diagnosis. But it should be also measured for proper diagnosis. Now, if we just look at the primary hypoparathyroidism, it is autoimmune in nature. Then same as we in the last slide, this is for your ease the two identify. In pseudo, there will be high receptor defects, which is the gene defect. Here you can differentiate that it is low, it is high because of the resistance, and other parameters are almost same pattern. Then vitamin D deficiency can also lead to mildly high or low or normal. Then calcium will be low and phosphorus will be low. This differentiates between these two different conditions. Primary hypoparathyroidism can be manifested by the low concentration of the PTH with the concomitant low calcium level. This is a very clear thing. This must be kept in mind. In pseudo hypoparathyroidism, serum PTH concentration is elevated as a result of the resistance to PTH caused by mutation in the PTH receptor system. These two things are important. Now, what are the causes of hypocalcemia? Apart from this one, there may be PTH deficiency or the resistance. There may be vitamin D deficiency or resistance, hypomagnesemia, hypoalbuminemia, hyperphosphatemia, medication effects, surgical effects. These are the causes of the hypocalcemia. Why we are discussing? Because it is the important question which may be asked, what are the different causes of the hypercalcemia or hypocalcemia? The acute manifestation of the hypocalcemia can be, for example, there may be tetany, which is a condition in which due to the low calcium, the patient may have some seizures or convulsions. Then one sign, that is Jobstick's sign, hypocalcemia leads to hyperexcitable nerves. Tapping of the facial nerve over here on the cheek, it leads to the contraction of the facial muscles. This is the typical sign of the hypocalcemia, which can be documented by examination. The second is the sign is the Proteus sign, in which we inflate the BP cuff over here and then allow it for about 10 to 20 minutes, up to 20 to 30 millimeter of mercury. And then after a few minutes, there will be a carpopedal spasm. This is also typical of acute manifestation of the and documentation of the hypocalcemia. Now, if we approach the patient, if there is a level bit less than 8.5, it must be albumin corrected. This is very important to understand that until and unless we document it, corrected calcium level, or we measure, otherwise we should measure this one, which is more important. If low ionized calcium or corrected calcium level is low, then we will measure phosphate level. And then we'll go for the PTH. If it is high, then these conditions can be like vitamin D deficiency, pancreatitis, anti-epileptic drug use, bisphosphonates, which are the drugs used for the osteoporosis and blood transfusion citrate. There is a repeated blood transfusion having a lot amount of the citrate can lead to this one. Then if the PTH is low, then hypoparathyroidism and hypomagnesemia should be considered. If PTH with along with the PTH, it is high, lower calcium and high phosphate, then PTH should be measured. If it is high, then acute renal failure, rhabdomyolysis, then pseudo hypoparathyroidism, massive tumor lysis syndrome. This is the syndrome in which there is due to some specific event like overexertion or infection, drugs use. This can lead to the use of the or use of the certain medications. It is a condition of the skeletal muscle tissue in which there is death of the skeletal muscle, and there will be hyperphosphatemia, hyperkalemia, hypocalcemia, and hyperuricemia. There may be involvement of the kidney. So by this, we can diagnose different conditions and different causes of this one. These are the three things must be kept along with this one. Then we should proceed in this manner. Now, a 58 years old woman who has recently undergone a successful renal transplantation for end stage renal failure can present with thyrotoxicosis, primary hyperparathyroidism, milk alkali syndrome, tertiary hyperparathyroidism, Paget's disease. What should be the answer? First of all, what is the key in this to think about? Renal transplantation is successful. End stage patient was of the end stage renal failure. There could have been some, it cannot be thyrotoxicosis, primary hyperparathyroidism. This cannot be milk alkali syndrome, cannot be there. Paget's disease is totally different. Now you may be confused with this one or this one, but when you go for this one, key is the then tertiary hyperparathyroidism. It means that there is definitely end stage renal failure that causes resistance. In the next lecture, we'll discuss MCQ and the SCQ on the topic of the thyroid and parathyroid gland. So I request you that you go through these two topics, and so that although I will be giving the answers of the questions and MCQ, but you must be well prepared for this one. Thank you very much.